And speaking of changing the world with the power and message of the gospel, I am so honored to bring up your first speaker this morning. He's a guy that in my life and ministry, I look up to because of the beautiful things accomplished for Jesus Christ and because of the man that he is. Give it up for Curtis Martin.
To speak life, speak life, to the dead and darkest night. Speak life, when the sun will shine and you don't know why. Look into the eyes of the broken heart.
Good morning, Krakow. Who's ready to see the Pope? Woo! We know why he is here. He's here to be with you. But I want to talk to you this morning about why you are here. Why you have come to Krakow. Why God has called you. In many ways, you probably are here because a friend invited you or your parents told you to come. There might be many reasons that you think you're here, but actually the reason that you're here is much more because of what Chris just talked about. You were made to be amazing. And what I'd like to talk to you about is what God is hoping to do in your life this week. He's already begun that work, but he's going to do something amazing in your life. And so my thesis is this. We are going to spend some time together following Christ, getting radical with Jesus. I want to talk about the first step, what God is doing in you and through you to change your life. I want to talk about the first step. My thesis is this. St. Catherine of Siena said this about you, about each one of you, about me. She said, if you are what you were meant to be, you would set the world on fire. Amen. God is calling you to become who you're meant to be. The scriptures tell us that God chose you not when you were born, not even when you were conceived. We're told by the Apostle Paul that from the foundations of the world, God called you into existence. That means that when God said, let there be light, he was thinking about you. He was thinking about you, the specifics, the details, he knew you, he loved you. And then he waited for the right moment to allow the idea of you to become the reality of you. And you are here right now to become who you were meant to be so that you would set the world on fire. And I want to talk about the first step, the step that allows us to recognize that now is the moment, now is the time. Karl Wojtyła, St. John Paul II, lived in this city. He gave a talk in this city. As he came back as Pope, he reminded the Polish people of an amazing moment. I didn't know about this moment until Sister Maristella, one of the Sisters of Life. How about the Sisters of Life? Woo! I also want to give a shout out to the Knights of Columbus who have made all this happen. This is great. Knights of Columbus. Sister and I were talking, and she said, you might want to weave in the theme of Vesterplot. And I said, yes, I don't know what Vesterplot is. And so I looked it up. She sent me some information. I was reading. Vesterplot is actually a city here in Poland where World War II began. There were less than 200 Polish soldiers, and they were minding their own business. It was a day like any other day, maybe like this day is for you, a day like any other day. And then 10 times as many soldiers came against them. The Nazis came, and that day at Vesterplot, those soldiers, they didn't choose to fight that day. It was chosen for them. They were chosen to stand up and defend what they believed in, what they loved, their city, their country. John Paul came back and said, for each of us, we must find our own Vesterplot. The moment when God chooses you, when you become aware of his choice from the foundations of the world, comes alive inside of you. This is what I'd like to talk to you about. I'd like to talk about the way to start our faith together, to become the men and women that God has designed us to be. Pope Benedict told us how to bring about the new evangelization. He said if we would read the Bible every day, if we would read the Bible every day, just for a few minutes, quietly, slowly, if we would read the Bible, what the church calls Lectio Divina, a prayerful reading of the Bible. Now, I've read the Bible, maybe you have too. But what we have to recognize is that sometimes we read the Bible like it's a textbook or a magazine. We read it very quickly. And this is not what Lectio Divina is about. Lectio is reading slowly and carefully and prayerfully, allowing not just our mind to understand what the Bible says, but allowing our heart to penetrate the meaning, to allow our imagination to be able to take an impact in our life, to actually, as we read the Gospels, to imagine Jesus, what he looked like, what he sounded like, his facial expressions. If we were to read the Bible every day, slowly and prayerfully, it would bring about, Pope Benedict said, the new springtime. You, brothers and sisters, are here with the Holy Father to become who you're meant to be so you could set the world on fire. And we do that through regular, prayerful reading of the Scriptures. I want to give you an example of that. We'll take a look at how do we read the Scriptures prayerfully and carefully. So I've been doing this for a while, and just trying to figure out what's going on. I want to bring you into a reading of the Gospel of John. The next day, this is John chapter 1, verse 35. The next day, again, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked, and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." And the two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. Now, here's the setting. If you're going to do Lectio Divina, you want to know the where this is in the Scriptures and what's going on. This is early. This is John chapter 1. And there are two disciples of John the Baptist, and they found John the Baptist. And John the Baptist out there, repent! And he's intense. He's wearing heavy clothes made of animal skins and eating honey. Could you imagine trying to get honey? There's no stick. He had to go into a beehive and rip it out with his hands. This is a tough guy. And he's yelling at people, the leaders, repent, you brood of vipers. And to the weak, saying, come and repent. God wants to heal you. And he's got disciples, and two of them are just, they're watching him like, oh, this is amazing. And then one day, Jesus shows up. And they've listened to John, and John has been saying, repent. And change the way you live. And all of a sudden, he looks at Jesus. They've never seen Jesus before. And John says, behold the Lamb of God. Behold the Lamb of God. And they watch. And this is the day that Jesus gets baptized. So Jesus comes up to John, just said he was the Lamb of God. And he walks down into the water. And John says, I shouldn't baptize you. You should baptize me. But John loses the argument. And so he baptizes Jesus. And when Jesus is baptized, a dove descends out of heaven. And there's a voice that says, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. The same thing that God says about you on the day of your baptism. This is my beloved Son or daughter in whom I am well pleased. And he says that about you today. He says that about you today. And so the Spirit descends, and all of a sudden, John says, I must decrease and he must increase. And his disciples are confused because they're thinking, John's the guy. But John is saying that this guy, Jesus, is the guy. And they're looking. And so this is the very next moment in the Gospel of John. Jesus starts to walk away. And there are two of his disciples. They're looking, and they're like, well, there goes Jesus, but here's John. And they don't know what to do. And they're thinking, well, John's the guy. No, wait, John said Jesus is the guy. And so two of them started to walk after Jesus. And as Jesus is going off, and in my mind, in my imagination, Jesus is walking away, and the two guys are like, we should go. So they're walking behind Jesus, and Jesus is way over here. And he's walking along. Have you ever been walking along and you think somebody's looking at you? So Jesus is walking along, and he looks back, and there's these two guys back there. And the two guys back there, they're walking along, and Jesus turns around, and they're like, oh. And Jesus walks on a little further, and they walk on a little further, and they don't know what they're doing. They don't know what they're doing. But they're following Jesus. And Jesus turns back, and he says to them, what do you seek? And they look at him, and they say, where are you staying? And he says, come and see. Come and see. And we're told in John chapter 1 that they came and they stayed with him. And then it says something that's kind of interesting. It says, and it was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, I don't know how much of the Bible you've read. I've been trying to read the Bible. The Bible's a big book. No pictures. This is the New Testament. It's a tiny little portion of the Bible. This is the New Testament. In the New Testament, we learn about Jesus. At the end of John's Gospel, John is going to tell us something. He's going to say, if everything Jesus said and did was written down, all the books in the world would not contain it. All the books in the world. And we have just a tiny little section. And as I'm reading this, it says, and it was 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, why in the world would we need to know it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon? Of all the things they could have told us, they're telling us the time? This was frustrating for me. In fact, as you work with the scriptures, as you read the scriptures, my encouragement is that you would begin the habit of the daily reading of sacred scripture. And when you do, God wants to wrestle with you. There are things in the scriptures that will allow you to wrestle. Two main issues. The first are the things you don't understand. I don't understand this. St. Augustine, reading the scriptures more than 1,000 years ago, said that God has placed difficulties in the scriptures so that we will come back and read them over and over and over again. He wants us to come back to the scriptures. And so things that I read that I don't understand, I'll have to read it again. The other one are things that you clearly understand, and they're just very difficult to do. You want me to forgive who? How often? Oh my goodness, I can't possibly live that way. I was reading the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, and it was amazing. I was listening to a priest friend of mine talk about the Sermon on the Mount, and as I read it, I was thinking, I don't even know if I'm a Christian. I mean, half the things in here I can't do. I'm told to forgive and to love and to be perfect. And my priest friend told me, actually, Jesus is talking about himself and how we are to imitate him. So you're going to find things in the scriptures that you don't understand and things that you do understand, but they're very difficult. This would be one of the ones I don't understand. 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Why do I need to know that 2,000 years later? Let me tell you why that's frustrating. If you look in my Bible, in John chapter 1, and you flip back one page, you're at the end of Luke's gospel. The end of Luke's gospel. That's what I had been reading the week before. The week before, I had been thinking and reading about this, and when you're prayerfully reading the scriptures, you may read the same section several days in a row. You're not trying to get through the Bible, you're trying to get into the Bible. And as I read that, I read a passage that you all know. It's been read to us just after Easter every year since you were young. The Road to Emmaus. In the Road to Emmaus, there are two disciples, and they're walking on a road. It's about a 6 or 7 mile walk from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And they're walking along, and it's Easter Sunday. Not any Easter Sunday, the Easter Sunday. And as they're walking along, Jesus shows up. But they don't recognize him. And they're walking along. And you can imagine disciples of Jesus. And they're just, you know, it's tough. What just happened this week? Most amazing and horrible week in some ways of our life. And they're walking along. And it's mile after mile, and Jesus shows up, and they don't recognize him. And they're walking along, and he says, in my imagination, it's the conversation goes something like this. Ah, how's it going? What do you mean, how's it going? I mean, you're obviously walking from Jerusalem. Are you the only person who didn't hear about Jesus? I mean, we thought he was the Messiah. We were convinced. We watched him work miracles. He's amazing. And then they captured him and they killed him on Friday. And this morning, the body's gone. How could you not have heard this? And Jesus walks with them. And in my mind, it went on for miles. Jesus probably said, so where did you meet this Jesus? And one of them said, well, you know, I was down in Jerusalem, and I watched him forgive a woman. They were going to kill her. She was caught in adultery. And they had rocks. They were ready to go. They were about ready to kill him. And Jesus said, let him among you who has no sin cast the first stone. And I was amazed. One by one, they just dropped the rocks and walked away. And Jesus walked up to her and said, I forgive you. Sin no more. And I thought, if he could forgive her, maybe he could forgive me. You knew. Where did you meet Jesus? Oh, well, I was up in Galilee, and he gave this sermon on a mountain. It was amazing. I mean, he told me things that I'd never heard before. I went back and told my parents, I have to leave. I have to go follow him. I think this is the Messiah. And so Jesus walks with them. He hears their concerns, their heartache, as Jesus has died and risen, but they don't know he's risen. They just know the body's missing. And then Jesus begins to speak after maybe, I don't know, an hour of talking with them. And Jesus turns to them and says, O foolish men and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Then we're told, in beginning with Moses, in other words, beginning at the beginning of the Bible, Moses wrote the first five books, beginning with Genesis, beginning with Moses and all of the prophets, Jesus interpreted to them the scriptures and the things concerning himself. On the road to Emmaus, this was the greatest Bible study in the history of the world. Jesus explained the entire Bible as they walked. And there's not a single word about what he said. Not one. But if you turn the page, it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Why are they leaving the most important pieces out and including things that don't seem to make any difference? And this was a difficulty for me as I sat and looked at the scriptures. Why? Why is it in there? Because who's doing the editing? Well, the challenge is that the Holy Spirit did the editing. The scriptures are exactly the way they're supposed to be. So the fact that the greatest Bible study in the history of the world isn't included is for a reason. And if you turn the page, to know that it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon is also there for a very specific reason. But why? And so I began to think and pray. I read this several days. Why is it there? And it hit me. You know, John, the Apostle John, the author of the Gospel, the Apostle John is the last of the apostles to die. By the time he wrote this Gospel, all the other apostles had been martyred. They'd been killed. John is an old man. He's been sent off to an island. He's in exile. And he's a mystic. He's in deep in prayer. And one day in prayer, Jesus comes to him and says, John, tell my story. Oh, Lord, I mean, Matthew and Mark and Luke wrote your story beautifully. But John, you're my beloved disciple. Tell my story. And so John goes deep into his memory to think about the man who changed his life. the Savior of the world. And as he spent, as he thought and prayed and began to write, he said, how do I tell the story of Jesus? It's not clear in John's gospel who the two disciples of John the Baptist are, but from the other gospels, it's clear that the two disciples are Andrew, Peter's brother, and John, James's brother. And so John is actually there. And as he tells the story of Jesus under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, as he tells that story, he goes back to the beginning and he thinks, how did it all begin? You know, I remember Andrew and I were there, and we were following John the Baptist. And we thought he might have been the Messiah, but he told us he wasn't. And then one day, Jesus showed up. Jesus showed up, and John said some things I've never heard before. He said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And Andrew and I looked at one another, who is this guy? And then he baptized him, and a dove descended. And we heard the voice, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. And then John looked at us and looked at Jesus. And then he said, I must decrease and he must increase. And I remember it like yesterday. Jesus started to walk away, and Andrew and I were looking at one another saying, we like John. There goes Jesus. John, Jesus, John. And we started to follow him. And we were walking after him. And I remember at one point in time, he looked back, and we were like, but we kept following him. And then Jesus turned to us. He said, what do you seek? And we said, where are you staying? And he said, come and see. And we came. And we stayed with him. Gosh, I remember that day. It's the afternoon. I remember that day. It's about 4 o'clock. Because at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, that day, my life changed. At 4 o'clock, 50 years ago, 60 years ago, I met Jesus. At 4 o'clock, I would never be the same again. And my question to you, in Krakow, in the shadows of St. John Paul II, in the presence of Pope Francis, what is your 4 o'clock? Has Jesus become so real to you that you could never live the same way again? Let this week be your 4 o'clock to encounter Christ, to meet him, and to say, I could never be the same again. I will choose to follow you. It takes a moment when we come face to face. It frequently happens while we read the scriptures. It might happen in front of the Blessed Sacrament. It might happen on a pilgrimage. I hope it does if it hasn't. It could happen with friends while you're hiking in the mountains. It doesn't really matter where you are, but that you take the moment to recognize who Jesus Christ is and to recognize that he created you out of love. He called you into existence to be alive right now because the world is desperately waiting for you to become who you were meant to be. For you to become who you were meant to be in Christ so that you all, each of you, could set the world on fire. 50 years ago, a Polish priest in this town began to meet with college students. Not many, maybe 10 or 12, maybe 20. And he began to spend time with them. And he lived with them and he loved them. Kind of like Jesus did with the apostles 2,000 years ago. But this priest did it 50 years ago. And then by the grace of God and the call of the Holy Spirit, that priest was made a bishop and then a cardinal. and then a pope. And St. John Paul II founded World Youth Day. And you have been invited to World Youth Day now in his hometown to recognize this, not just now one priest with 20 or so people, but it's tens of thousands of priests gathered with millions of young people, all of whom are called by God to become who you're meant to be, to allow yourselves to live totally differently, to not listen to the culture, to not become a consumer, but rather to become a saint, to become the man or woman that God's called you to, because at your 4 p.m., at your 4 o'clock, you met Jesus, and you became who you were meant to be. Please, my appeal to you is, meet Jesus, establish your 4 o'clock, become who you were meant to be, and set the world on fire. Thank you.
To speak life, to speak life, to the deadest, darkest night.
Amen.
Speak life, when the sun won't shine and you don't know why. Look into the
earth. It's when we encounter Jesus that we realize who we are. Amen? You know how little kids realize who they are? I have 6 kids, by the way. Go make disciples. I'm half Irish Catholic. We take that very literally. They don't learn who they are by looking in a mirror. Before they can say their name, before they can make sense of anything, they learn who they are by looking at their parents. They learn right away, and they can only see about from your arms to your face when they're first born. And if you're adopted, you learn this from your adoptive parents. They learn right away, who am I? I'm precious. What am I worth? I'm worth dying for. It's that encounter with Jesus Christ that teaches us not only who God is, but who we are. It's that encounter that Andrew had when he said, come and see where I'm staying. It's that encounter that the woman caught in adultery had when she thought this is the end of the road. And a man stood above her and lifted her up and said, go and sin no more. It's that encounter that Peter had when he said, get away from me, Lord, you got the wrong guy. Or in scriptural language, depart from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. And Jesus looked down at him and said, no. I see more in you than you see in you. Come follow me, I'll make you a fisher of men. Brothers and sisters, when we turn our eyes to Jesus Christ, we realize who we are, what our worth and value and dignity are, and the lofty calling he's given to each of us to be world changers. Amen? And if hearing what I'm saying right now and hearing Curtis's talk, you're thinking, me, world changer? No, I'm disqualified from that kind of high and lofty thing because of whatever stupid sin is lying to me, telling me I'm disqualified. I want you to deal with that lie, with that sin. I want you to unload it right here, and back in the chapel. There are priests offering confession, waiting to unburden you from that lie that you're carrying around. So I want you to take advantage of that right now. Amen? Another thing I want you to take advantage of, guys. A quick announcement. After the Mass this morning, this day continues. There's great stuff offered for you all day at the Love and Life Center. One of the things offered to you is air conditioning. So cool. It's awesome, man. I love air conditioning. We got great speakers, Vicky Thorne, Lee Labresco. We have Jason Ever talking about the 5 loves of John Paul II. It's really amazing stuff. At 2 o'clock is an hour of mercy. There's a chapel back there with all sorts of relics and things. So beautiful stuff waiting for you all day long. And speaking of world changers, I'm really blessed again to bring up our next speakers, people who are close friends of mine, amazing people who give their life to the service of God and to the sacrament of marriage where they live out their vocation to become like Jesus Christ. Give it up for Scott and Annie Powell. Show them some love. Make some noise.
Anytime, anywhere, any place. It's written all over your face.
Let me hang it.
Hello, everybody. How's the morning been? Oh, come on. How's the morning been? Awesome. Well, thank you for having us. Thanks to the Sisters of Life, to the Knights of Columbus, to the whole city of Krakow, to Chris. Thanks to Curtis. Let's give it up for Curtis's talk one more time. Woo. Awesome. Well, way back in 1979, Pope St. John Paul II had just become Pope, and one of the first things he did was come back here to his hometown of Krakow, and he spoke to the people, he spoke to his countrymen, huge crowds, not unlike this one, people who were suffering under the weight of a regime who was trying to take away their dignity, and he looked at them, he looked them in the eye and he said, "You are not who they say you are. Let me remind you who you are. You are not who they say you are. Let me remind you who you are." Now, I don't think it's any surprise to say that we all live in a culture in which there's a lot of confusing, often contradictory voices trying to tell you who you are, trying to tell us what it means to be a Catholic man or woman, trying to tell us what it means to be a human being, trying to confuse us about what marriage is. We live in a time when there's a lot of confusion about what marriage is and what marriage is supposed to be. You know, when I was younger, when I was first getting serious about my Catholic faith around college, I had a lot of misunderstandings about what marriage was. I became really serious about my faith, and I thought, if I want to really be holy, and if I want to evangelize and spread the gospel and do good things for the church, I thought that the only way I could possibly do that was by becoming a priest, which is a very good thing, but I didn't feel called to the priesthood. But I had a misunderstanding, and I thought, no, if you want to be holy, you have to be a priest or religious. And I wasn't a sister, so priests seemed like the only option for me. But I misunderstood what it meant to actually have marriage. I thought that if I was called to marriage, then what I had to worry about was my family and my kids and making money and paying for mortgages and doing all that stuff. And I didn't understand that for the mind of the church, that is far too small. The church sees marriage as a holy adventure.
I was also confused about what marriage was. Even though I grew up in a good Catholic home that modeled strong marriage for me, hi, Mom and Dad, I very much was afraid of marriage. I thought it was just settling down, a time to quiet your dreams and really quiet the adventure. The biggest dream I ever had was when I was 15 years old. I was at a youth conference, a little smaller than this, and the speaker said, "Write a mission statement for your life, because if you don't know where you're going, you're gonna get lost." So I remember going up to my room and thinking, "Lord, what's my mission?" And since I didn't have the answer to that, I remember thinking, "Well, Lord, you speak through the desires of our heart. That is what Scripture tells us. So I'm gonna write down what I love." And in that time, I wrote down four things. "Lord, I love you. I love bringing people to you. I loved my summer camp. I grew up going to this incredible wilderness program in Southern Illinois in the United States. And I loved creation. I grew up in the city, shout out to Chicago. And we came out to Colorado every summer to enjoy these beautiful mountains. And there it was, four things. I love you, God, bringing people to you, my summer camp, and the created world. And it was that moment that the Holy Spirit ordained this dream. I said, "That's it. I want to bring people to you, Lord, through creation in a summer camp setting." But I was 15. I couldn't really do much for that dream, but I could tell people about that dream. But when I told people what that dream was, they confirmed my fears of marriage. They said, "How could you ever do that and get married? How could you ever do that and have a family?" And so I thought, maybe this dream is too big for marriage.
You know, one of the things that began to change our minds and our hearts about what marriage is and what it's supposed to be, it's actually a passage from the Catechism of the Catholic Church that was only a few years ago that we discovered this. But in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, in the section on the sacraments, there's one paragraph that says there are two sacraments, matrimony and a holy order, so marriage and the priesthood, that are specifically directed toward the salvation of others. They're directed outward. The rest of the sacraments, things like baptism and the Eucharist and confession, they're meant for our salvation, to build us up. But those two, matrimony and holy orders, are meant for the world. Now, again, my job as a husband and as a father is to make sure my wife and my kids get to heaven. I've kind of failed if I don't do that. But again, for the mind of the church, they take that for granted. Yeah, you're supposed to be holy. Yeah, you're supposed to, your family is supposed to be holy. But the church says, no, marriage is supposed to be a witness. The world should look at marriage. The world should look at family life and see that is a holy adventure. The world should be inspired by marriages who want to go out and serve the church.
Now here's the catch. When I met Scott, he had similar dreams. And even though I wasn't sure if I was called to marriage, I couldn't deny the connection that we had and the passion that we both had for sharing the gospel, specifically through outdoor adventure. A wise person once told me, when you're thinking about who to date, you just have to run after Jesus. First and foremost, that is your call, to run after Jesus. Then you look to your right, then your left, and you see who's running with you. And that is the person you should consider dating. And as I was running towards Jesus, and as Scott was running towards Jesus, we found each other. And well, the rest is history.
You can throw up that picture of our wedding. Aww.
And so here we are in the very beginning of our married life together. And it was just 1 year into our married life that all the pieces started coming together for that dream that I was telling you about to reach fruition. And we were putting together a Catholic adventure program that would bring people closer to the Lord through creation. We named it after our hero, St. JP2, and it's called Camp Wojtyła. And it was as if God was saying to me, that dream was never just for you. It was always for the both of you. Now, in these early years of our marriage, we were open to life, but no babies came. We were living our dream. We had a graduate degree that we were pursuing as well. We weren't that worried about it. But it was interesting because the longing, we just had such a longing for children. And specifically, we felt this deep tug in our hearts towards adoption. We had barely uttered the word adoption when into our life came a 15-year-old girl who was 7 months pregnant. And she decided to place her baby into our family and into our home. There is no more humbling thing on this planet. And so we welcomed into our lives Lily Avila Powell. And when Lily was 9 months old, we got the devastating news that we were completely infertile. We would never have a biological child. Well, and that's not true. If we did, we could write the Vatican to claim the miracle of that biological child. But the thought of building our family became confusing. So we decided to keep praying for another adoption. We desperately wanted to have another child, and specifically desperately wanted to have a sibling for Lily. Even though we were told it would be 2 to 4 years before we had another successful adoption, we get a call from an agency out of state who heard about our family and our great desire. And they asked us if we would consider adopting a baby boy in 1 to 3 weeks. In 2 weeks, we became a family of four, and we welcomed home Samuel Isaac Powell.
You can throw up that next picture. So God turned a marital mission into a whole family mission. And those of us, those people who've worked at Camp Wojtyła or have attended the program, they know that the pals are a package deal. And if you've worked for Camp Boytee or have attended, we do ministry as a family. It's a family mission because that's how God designed it. And that's how things good. And so I love that you cheered for the picture. We have a great looking family. I am not ashamed to say that. And you can throw up the next one now. We have a good looking family. And so often people will look at our family and they'll say, wow, this is perfect. It's a beautiful family. Everything worked out. These two children found a home. Your infertility's worked out. Everything's great. And that's true. It is great. And it is beautiful. And God brought huge blessings. But nothing good, nothing beautiful, nothing holy comes without the cross. That's just the way that God designed it. The cross is always there when God moves us forward. And we've faced the cross in a big way. You know, Curtis mentioned just a few minutes ago my favorite story from the Bible, the story of the road to Emmaus. Again, it comes at the end of the Gospel of Luke, this moment on Easter Sunday. Jesus has risen from the dead. Nobody knows about it yet. Everyone's a little confused. And traditionally, those two people that are walking away from Jerusalem, having been disappointed, traditionally, it's been suggested that they're actually a married couple, a husband and a wife. And if you think of that image that Curtis mentioned, these two people are walking away from Jerusalem. That's where the apostles are, the fledgling church. They're walking away from the church disappointed. They've been let down. And Jesus finds them and he says, what are you guys talking about? And they say, well, have you not heard about all this stuff? And then they have the key line. They say, we had hoped Jesus was going to be the one to redeem Israel. We had hoped. In other words, we don't hope anymore. We've given up hope. We're giving up. We're walking away. How many people, how many marriages, how many families, how many of us, when we face the cross, when we face disappointment or something that's not how we thought it should be, we want to walk away disappointed, let down?
We had hoped that I would carry our children in my womb. We had hoped we would have those 9 months to care for them, to love them, and to protect them. But here's the deal. We were called to have Lily and Samuel as our children. God wanted us to be their parents. I don't need children that are of my DNA. But I do love having Lily and Samuel as my children. And if that was God's plan, and that was God's plan from the beginning of time, for all of eternity, I was supposed to be their mom, Scott was supposed to be their dad, and they were supposed to be our children. Therefore, this had to work out in a different way than what we had hoped.
One of the key moments in that story of the road to Emmaus is when Jesus begins, like Curtis said, he gives the best Bible study ever, opens all the scriptures, the whole Old Testament. But he has an important line in there, and Jesus looks at this couple and he says, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? Was it not necessary? Here's the thing, you guys. I don't believe in a God who just brings silver linings once in a while. I don't believe in a God who looks at all the baggage and the things in our lives and the hurt that we carry with us and says, well, you have these terrible situations, but maybe I can bring a little good out of it. I believe in a God that is always in control and that wants to look at us and say, was it not necessary? Our kids, Lily and Samuel, experienced a lot of trauma during those 9 months that we didn't have them when they were in the womb, and abuse, and things that they're going to have to deal with for the rest of their lives. We have never experienced anything that's been as difficult as that cross. And I hope and I believe in a God that's not going to look at us someday and say, well, at least I worked out some of those things, and there's some silver linings. But a God who's going to look at me and say, Scott, was it not necessary that Lily and Samuel should suffer these things so that I can make them into the saints that I want them to be? Scott, Annie, was it not necessary that you suffered with this cross so that I could make you the parents that I designed you to be? Was it not necessary? The way the road to Emmaus story ends is that even after the best Bible study on earth, they still don't get it. Their eyes aren't open. They don't recognize Jesus until they go and gather at table with them. They share the Eucharist with Jesus. They receive communion. And it's only at that moment that their eyes are opened. And they see Jesus for who he is, and I believe they see themselves for who they are. They recognize their identity and the truth of their lives. You guys, the only way that we can carry these crosses, that we can be the marriage that God wants us, that we can raise the family that he's asking us to, is if we cling close to the sacraments. we receive the Eucharist, confession, and we take all the graces that God has available to us so that every single day our eyes can be opened new every morning to see the reality of who we are, so that God can look us in the eyes, tell us it's necessary, and remind us who we are. Guys, don't forget to receive those sacraments, to enter into that grace so that God can look at you and say, you are not who the world says you are. And let Jesus remind you who you are. Thank you guys so much.
Yeah. I think I hear a little thunderstorm right now. I think I hear some weather coming. Look, when I point to your part of the crowd, okay, I want you to do what I start doing with my hands. And you keep doing it until I point to your part of the crowd again. This is going to be really cool, okay? So just follow me. So the first thing is this. All right? Don't do it yet. Not until I point to your part of the crowd. Okay, here it is. Ready? Starting from the way top. Go ahead. Shh. Listen. All right, y'all, keep doing that. The next thing is this, okay? Okay, next thing is this. All right. Next thing is a clap. Now we're gonna add the feet. Yeah, that's cool. You know, guys, sometimes we don't feel like we matter. Like, our yes to God makes much of a difference. You know, like, we're just drops of water. What difference do we make? And when we look at the problems of the world, we think, what can I contribute? What can I do? Guys, you know something? One in every seven people on planet Earth is a Catholic. What if instead of saying, geez, what could I do? We all say, hey, what could I do? And we do something for maybe six other people. We got the whole planet covered. When we make the radical choice that we see from Curtis and Scott and Annie to make our lives a gift instead of making our lives about us, we become world changers. And God begins to shape our dreams so that we can shape the world around us. But we have to step outside of our skin, step outside of our comfort zones, step onto the water to discover what those dreams are, to discover how God is calling us to serve Him. We have to make conscious choices to do that every single day, from the smallest ways to opening up a door for that person who annoys the heck out of you at your school, to instead of saying everything is about you, you know, saying, look, how can I serve my family today? You know, I mean, believe it or not, your parents don't exist only to serve you. I know, it's shocking. But in that family, that school of love, to learn to serve them. You know, to think about your friends and think, you know, who around me needs to hear the gospel message of Jesus Christ? Who do I need to share my faith with? I know it's uncomfortable to step outside your skin like that. It's uncomfortable for me. Look, it's comfortable here. It would be awkward here if I didn't talk about Jesus. In my daily life, I struggle with it just like you do. One of my most profound struggles I ever had with that, I was at the bedside of my wife's grandma as she was dying. She was dying of pneumonia. She was struggling breathing, and it was the end of her life. She was over 90 years old, and she didn't practice any faith at all. And it was one of those times of the new guy to the family. I didn't want to rock the boat. My father-in-law is an agnostic, doesn't believe in anything. I just wanted to stay in my own comfort zone, in my own skin, you know? But I know that years before, she had told my wife she thought she was going to go to hell. I didn't know why. I didn't know what secret she had. But I'm standing there, and I realized, you know, this isn't comfortable. But God is calling me to serve right now. He's calling me to speak truth. I have to say something. So I got up really close to this sweet lady's bedside, put my face near her ear, and I said, "Repent!" Yes, I'm kidding. Like, psycho. I got really close to her. I said, "Look, Jesus was crucified next to a thief who did nothing good his whole life. At the end of his life, he said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. He said, you know, he went to heaven that day, not because of what he did, but because of what Jesus did for him. I said, that thief could be you. The next day she was received into the Catholic Church. The day after that, she died. What if I stayed in my comfort zone? What if I made life about me in that moment and thought, I don't want to get my father-in-law mad at me, I don't know. What if I didn't say anything? What if you don't? What if John Paul II stayed inside his comfort zones? What if Sister Faustina didn't respond to the call of God to become a sister? What if Father Colby didn't step out of line at Auschwitz and offer his life for another prisoner? What if you don't step outside of your skin to follow the dreams that God has planted in your heart? I don't know. But I'm begging y'all, please respond with a generous and open heart. And on that note, I'm honored to bring up our next speaker who has responded to God with a generous and open heart. He's from the Philippines. Where's my Filipino brothers and sisters? Be real loud. Yeah! I'm telling you guys, in all my travels and all the world, speaking, Philippines stands out like such a shining light on this planet for the Catholic faith. And they also have the best mangoes in the world. Give it up, guys, for Cardinal Tagle. Give it a real loud.
Thank you. Good morning. Good morning to everyone. Good morning. First of all, I would like to bring to all of you warm greetings from the Philippines. Greetings from the Philippines. Wow. I thought I would be giving a catechesis in a church. But this is a church. This is the church, the living church. Here. Before I start my formal sharing, which will be informal, I tell you, may I know who among you are really and truly young? And who among you are pretending to be young? How many of us here are young at heart? Wow, wow, so all of us. Wow, good, good, good. Now, the theme of today's catechesis is, let us allow ourselves to be touched by God's mercy. And I would like to start by asking the Lord, Lord, open my lips. Lord, open our hearts. From the Gospel according to St. Luke, the 15th chapter, verses 1 to 10. The tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to listen to Jesus. But the Pharisees and scribes began to complain, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So to them he addressed this parable. What man among you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, would not leave the 99 in the desert and go after the lost one until he finds it. And when he does find it, he sets it on his shoulders with great joy. And upon his arrival home, he calls together his friends and neighbors and says to them, "Rejoice with me, because I have found my lost sheep." I tell you, in just the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who have no need of repentance. Or what woman having 10 coins and losing one would not light a lamp and sweep the house, searching carefully until she finds it? And when she does find it, she calls together her friends and neighbors and says to them, "Rejoice with me, because I have found the lost coin." In just the same way, I tell you, there will be rejoicing among the angels of God over one sinner who repents. O Lord, open my lips. O Lord, open our hearts. The parable of the lost sheep and the lost coin is presented to us by the organizers of the Days of Catechesis as the starting point for today's reflection. The theme, as I said earlier, is, "Let us allow ourselves to be touched by God's mercy." At first glance, at first hearing, the theme sounds, well, questionable. I was asking myself, if you are the lost sheep, if you are the lost coin, would you not welcome someone who wants to take you home? Why do we need a topic like this? Let us open ourselves, let us allow ourselves to be touched by God's mercy. Can we not just presume that everyone here is open enough to be touched by God's mercy? On second thought, and upon looking at my own experience, I have to say, we need this topic because we often do not allow God to touch us. The lost sheep. Why will a sheep get lost? According to some scholars, a lost sheep could either be wounded or sick or plainly dumb. The 99 are going that way, you go this way. Well, you are dumb. The teacher says, "Raise your right hand," and you raise 2 feet. Well, okay, you're lost. I guess all of us here could recall an instance in our lives where we could say, "I am that lost sheep." Or a lost coin, maybe misplaced, maybe carelessly thrown on the chair or somewhere. Sometimes you feel you're in the wrong place. you don't belong. And you ask, should I be here? Maybe I should be replaced by a better coin. Yes, lost sheep, lost coin. But if you are lost, you would want to be found. But how come the theme tells us it is possible that even if you're lost, you would not welcome the one who tries to find you? My dear young people, today we are being invited, with the help of God's grace, to open ourselves to be touched by God's mercy and not to be afraid to open ourselves, for the one who comes to touch us is a merciful God. But let us reflect on what are the possible causes of the closing of our hearts. Why is it possible for us to say, no, leave me alone, I don't need your mercy? Are there parents here? Are there parents here, guardians? Yeah. Good. Thank you. Thank you for coming. And I guess this session is also for you. How are we forming our children, our young people? Are we forming them to be open, to be touched by God's mercy? I'll give you a few phenomena in our time, in our world. Nowadays, everyone wants to be successful. Success is the goal of life. You need to be an achiever. And the more you achieve, your self-worth goes higher. In fact, even in church, my being a cardinal, some people say to me, wow, you have achieved so much. Everything is measured according to achievement, success. When I was newly ordained as a deacon, and I would go to some village chapels in the Philippines, nobody wanted to come with me. Nobody. No altar server, no choir member, no. You are just a deacon. So go by yourself. Then I got ordained a priest. Wow, and so many volunteers among the altar boys. Father, may I serve at your mass? And then so many not so young and some young people said, we will sing at your mass. Of course, they want to be with Father. And they also will enjoy the lunch or snack that is given to Father. And then I became a bishop. Wow. Everyone in the town says, you are my nephew. You are my relative. Hey. And they say, your achievement is our common achievement. And now, so when I say I'm from the Philippines, all the Filipinos say, ah! Everyone says, I know him. Just yesterday, said, oh, Eminence. So I said, yes. Oh, I said, oh, are you enjoying? And he said, yes, of course I am. And then he said, how is Korea?
I'm not from Korea. I'm from the Philippines. But they see this red sash, this red cap, and they say, I want to be close to him. His achievement is my achievement. Our world is measuring human beings by our achievement. And very often, we measure ourselves by that. What have I achieved? And to be successful, you don't tolerate failure. The greatest sin of our time is to say, I have failed. And it is a no-no to say, I cannot do it. We always convince ourselves, you can be what you want to be. And do it by yourself. Because if you allow others to help you, to guide you, or to do it for you, you do not qualify as successful. And so, in our libraries, you have a lot of books, self-help books. You can fix the faucet by yourself. You can construct your apartment by yourself. Everything self-help, so that I can be a self-made human being. And it is an insult to me if I say, somebody else made me who I am. And so I protect myself, but I'm actually protecting my pride. I don't need anyone. I can handle this. And I deny my wounds. I deny my being lost. It is embarrassing. I will lose my dignity. So leave me alone and let it be this way. I will do it my way. Those of my generation know that song. Sample? No. Nobody told me to sing, so I will recite it. The song says, and now the end is near. And so I face the final curtain. My friends, I'll state it clear. I state my case of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every byway. But more, much more than this, I did it my way. The clock says I should stop talking now. That is, we are all victims of this mistaken notion of human dignity, of human worth, where we say, leave me alone. I am okay. I don't need any help. The song continues, regrets? I have a few, but then again, too few to mention. I've forgotten the next line. I did what I had to do and saw it through without exemption. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew, but through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. Now that person
will not allow anyone, even God, to touch his heart, her heart, for it is an insult. But you know, dear brothers and sisters, if we deny our wounds, we will inflict wounds on others. Let me repeat that. If we do not face our wounds, if we live in an illusion that I don't have any scars, I don't have any needs, I will be harsh on other people, I will lose compassion. And we don't want that. How can we be compassionate to other people? Know that we need to be found. We need to be carried on the shoulders of someone who cares for us, someone who will leave the 99, someone who will sweep the whole house in search of you. And then when we ask the shepherd, you had 99 healthy sheep. Why? Why did you look for a sick, wounded, or dumb sheep? Why? You have 9 other coins. Why sweep the whole house for this one useless coin? And you know what the shepherd will say? What the woman who swept the house said? Yes, you may be a wounded sheep. You may be a lost, useless coin. But you are mine. You are mine. You belong to me. You don't have to prove. You don't have to earn my love. You are mine. You may be wounded. You may be scarred. You may be lost. You may be limping. But here I am. I will carry you home. If you cannot come home by yourself, I will walk for you, simply because you are mine. No other shepherd will be able to say that. And no other woman could say that to the lost coin. But God could say, you are mine. Have no fear. I know who you are. And your wounds, your sins can never diminish your worth for me.
He's got my vote for next Pope. How about that?
Goodbye.
No, no, no. You're not done yet. Come back. Come back. Come back. Asia needs its first Pope. We have some questions for you. We have some young people who have some questions for you.
Your Eminence, Cardinal Tagle. Thank you so much for being here with us. My name is Adrian Manalastas, and I am from Canada.
Oh. Yay!
So my question is, sometimes I find myself living my faith alone. How can I find the strength and courage to share my faith with others?
I'll see you in Canada. I'll be there in the first week of September. Yeah. Well, my dear young people, living the gospel will never be easy. In fact, Jesus experienced that. In the Gospel of St. John, he preached about himself as the bread of life, offering eternal life. Ooh. They left him, and he was left with the 12. And imagine the Lord of heaven and earth literally begging the 12 with the question, "Will you also leave me?" Our Lord was left alone, and towards Calvary, even some of the 12 left him. So, you should live by the faith conviction that you will never be alone. Friends might not mind you, they might ignore you, but someone said, "I will be with you till the end of the ages." And that is true. Even when you are like the voice in the wilderness, you know, in the wilderness, who listens to you? Your voice gets eaten up by the space. You say, "Hello, hello, hello, hello." It disappears. But God hears. Jesus will be with you. So courage. There is nothing wasted in your following of Jesus.
Thank you. Amen.
Your Eminence, Cardinal Tagle, yes. On behalf of all of the youth here, and especially us Filipino people, thank you so much for being here. Maraming salamat po.
Salamat.
My name is Zinjin Iglesia. I'm from Virginia in the United States. My question is, sometimes I find myself struggling to truly believe that God fully loves me and really knows me. And how can I experience His true love and knowledge of me?
Yes. Well, first of all, I studied in Washington, D.C. From 1985 to 91. So I was always in Virginia, Northern Virginia. Yes. Yeah. You know, realizing that God knows me, that God knows your struggles, is a matter of faith. We cannot prove that. No. We can only have what St. John's Gospel calls signs. Signs that must be interpreted with the eyes of faith. Without faith, they don't mean anything. But rely on the Word of God. Jesus continues to speak to us. He's alive. And when you read His words, and when you read the events in His life, you will discover that those events are still happening in your life. And so your life experiences are not distant from Jesus' own experience. So He understands. According to the letter to the Hebrews, He is our compassionate brother who has been tested in every way that we are tested, but He did not sin. But He can pray for us because He knows our struggles. But at the same time, this is the importance of friendship. We hope that through your parents, your guardians, your friends, you could be assured that you are known. You are known by God and that you are accepted. So please, do not make anyone feel, especially someone struggling, that he or she is alone and misunderstood. By your kindness and compassion, they will come to believe that the love of Jesus is real.
Thank you.
Amen.
You too.
Good morning, Your Eminence.
Good morning. Good morning.
What a gift and a joy it is to be with you here in this whole church together with you. My name is Chris, and I'm from New York.
Oh.
It seems like we're all searching for happiness in lots of different ways, whether through success or through work, through partying, or covering over our wounds. But what is the real happiness that Christ promises us?
Uh-huh.
How will I find this happiness?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Wow. This is another conference. Yeah. But it is a very rich question which requires a very rich answer. But let me just focus on two words of Jesus. Love one another as I have loved you. Love makes us happy. But not just any type of love, but the love that Jesus had for us. And then Jesus says, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. Love that shares. Love that sends. If you feel loved, then you should feel sent. You will be happy being loved and being sent to other people.
Thank you.
Amen.
Guys, give it up again real loud for our Cardinal this morning.
Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. Thank you. I'm very kind, I'm very kind.
And while we're showing the love, we have a couple of young people today, just like we did yesterday. We have three young people who are going to share the story of how Jesus Christ moved in their lives. So give them your full attention. Thanks, brother.
Good morning, fellow pilgrims. My name is Brett, and I'm a seminarian for the Diocese of Columbus, Ohio. Woo. So I'm guessing you've heard the word pilgrim a lot recently. But let me ask you, do you feel like a pilgrim yet? Or has the excitement of being here just totally overwhelmed you? When I arrived in Madrid in 2011 for my first World Youth Day, I felt more than a little overwhelmed. I was a college student then, and I went to World Youth Day as a volunteer with the Knights of Columbus. I had been considering seminary for a while, and I was hoping that my experience in Madrid would help to clarify my calling. I was a pilgrim looking for direction for the next stage of my journey. And World Youth Day Madrid taught me that in order to navigate this pilgrim road, I need to have my eyes on the final destination. Only then can we clearly discern the path in front of us. Only then can we make sense of the restlessness in our hearts. I learned this lesson as a volunteer in an arena much like this one. During my first day at the center, I was assigned to the floor level where many of you are sitting right now. And since my arrival in Madrid, my mind had been filled with all kinds of expectations for what I was going to experience there. So much so that I lost track of why I was there. As I walked casually in front of the stage, one of the adult volunteers stopped me and pointed to the altar that had just been placed for the upcoming Mass. After bowing in reverence to the altar, he looked to me and said softly, "Remember where you are. Don't lose sight of why you are here." This incident reminded me of my identity and destiny as a pilgrim. My true destination wasn't Madrid or the arena, or even the closing mass with the Holy Father. It was and is Jesus Christ. He is the one whom we reverence when we bow to an altar or when we venerate the relics of his saints, when we serve the poor, and when we speak truth. When we gather as Christians, whether there be two of us or 2 million. Fellow pilgrims, our destination is not Krakow, it is Jesus Christ. In a few days from now, this arena will be converted back into a sports complex, and Krakow will dwindle down to its normal size as we all go our separate ways. We might ask ourselves, what was it all for? My experience of World Youth Day in Madrid taught me that these intermediate pilgrimages only make sense if they lead us closer to our ultimate destination, our Lord Jesus Christ. In the remaining days of World Youth Day, I challenge you to keep your eyes on Christ. Be courageous in taking a step closer to him, for he is the way and the truth and the life, and he will never lead you astray. Thank you, and God bless.
Hi, everyone. My name is Crystal. I'm from Toronto, Canada. And this is my third World Youth Day. But I would like to share with you about my second World Youth Day. Now, I had stopped practicing my faith many years before I attended World Youth Day in Madrid. But in my view, everything was going great. I had graduated university with honors. I got a great job, great salary, got to go on really cool trips with my friends. But still, there was an emptiness inside. And no amount of fun or accomplishments or nice things seemed to fill this hole in my life. Then I started experiencing some personal problems. And then the house that I had built on sand started to crumble before my eyes. On the outside, I was doing great, but inside, I struggled with depression and hopelessness. So, when a spot opened up to attend World Youth Day in Madrid, I jumped at the chance to just fly far away from my problems. But nothing prepared me for what actually happened there. I was completely wowed by the amazing beauty of our Catholic faith during our catechesis sessions. The talk on chastity opened my eyes to a vision of real, authentic love that I had never heard before. I even found a new best friend, and I met the Sisters of Life, who walked with me for the next few years as I learned to practice my faith all over again. One of the most powerful moments for me was when I sat with Jesus in Eucharistic adoration, tears streaming down my face because I knew that Jesus was healing my soul. I received huge graces from Jesus to finally just let go of the control that I had over my life and just surrender my heart to God. But most importantly, I finally realized how much I was known and loved by Jesus and have always been my whole life. In that lonely, empty place inside me that longed for more, I encountered the goodness and the mercy of Jesus that truly satisfied. And I realized that he had been there the whole time, waiting for me and fighting for me my whole life. I am so grateful to God for World Youth Day, because it didn't just change my life, it saved my life. I came back home and, I mean, all the same problems were there, but I was different this time. I knew that I was not alone, and in everything, Jesus was on my side. He slowly rooted out all the sins, all the darkness in my life, holding my hand the whole way. Then he began to use me to shine his light on others too. I love that Jesus surprised me and that he found me at World Youth Day, even though I just went looking for travel and adventure and fun. He called me to World Youth Day so that I would know that he is passionately head over heels in love with me, and his love never runs out. And now that I belong to him, I know there is no sin, no fear, no scar that he will not heal in my life. And there is no hope, no dream, and no desire that he will not fulfill 1,000 times over. So please, open your heart to him today, because he wants to do the exact same thing for you. God bless you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm David, and I'm from Poland. I'm very honored to visit you and host you here in Poland, in Krakow, at World Youth Day. For me, this is an amazing experience of the church. So, I would like to share a little bit of myself with you today. Saint John Paul II has been a very inspirational person in my life. He, more than anyone, has taught me what is to be a man of the Christ. He gave me his Catholic faith, and he inspired me to live my Catholic faith to the full. I was born, raised in Poland with my mom and grandmother, who are amazing women. However, I didn't know my father, so I can say that John Paul II is a spiritual father of me. His words and his life inspired me and teach me and challenge me to set my life to the course for greatness. John Paul II taught me what is to be a man of God and how to persevere through the many challenges and struggles in life. In his famous speech, in Westerplatte, to young people, he inspired us to live courageously. And he said, "Even if others do not demand much from you, you must demand of yourselves. Each one of you will find in your life your own Westerplatte, a task you must assume and complete, some just cause in which it is impossible not to fight, some duty, some obligation from which you cannot escape and from which it is impossible to desert, a certain order of truth and values you are obliged to maintain and defend. In such a moment, and there are many of them, for they are not something exceptional. Remember, Christ is passing by you and saying, 'Follow me.' Do not abandon him. Do not run away. Hear that call." These words are a signpost for me to keep pushing through life. These words inspired me and teach me how to go through life demanding more of myself and knowing that at times I must go against the tide. I know that I may fall, but I will keep trying. We all face trials and sufferings in our life. When I experience failure, I'm thinking and I'm hearing John Paul II words, "Hope in spite of everything. Be not tempted to give up. Live courageously. Be faithful. Be not afraid, David. Be not afraid." To me, this is what it means to trust in Jesus and his Holy Mother Mary. This is what it means to be a son of Poland, a son of Pope John Paul II, and the son of God, who is my father. Thank you.
Praise God. I know some of you guys have out there been listening to all these beautiful reflections all morning. And some of y'all are thinking, you know, this isn't fully for me. This doesn't really apply to me. I have a word for you. A man had two sons. You know the story I'm about to tell, right? Yeah. It's like saying Mary had a little lamb. Every Catholic knows how the story ends. You know, I've heard that everyone Jesus was talking to also knew how the story ended because it was common back then to retell the stories of great rabbis, and this was one of them. A man had two sons. One of the sons went up to his father and had the awkward conversation, "Dad, you're going to die someday, right?" "Yeah, son." "Cool. Can I have your stuff now?" So he got his father's inheritance and squandered it on loose living. The modern equivalent of that would be called college. But no one here is going to do that, right? And he ruined his life. He ruined his life. He found himself starving to death. And he was feeding a pig, pig's food. And in Jewish tradition, a pig is an image of the devil. So he's feeding the devil's food. And he looks at the devil's food and his stomach growls. And he realizes, this is killing me. I'm malnourishing myself. I know what I'll do. I'll get up and go back to my father. Guys, I'm not sure he was really sorry. He was really hungry. I think that's a good starting point. It's enough for God. So he got up and ran back to his father and said, I'm telling my father, I've sinned against heaven. I've sinned against you. I don't deserve to be called your son. Just treat me as you treat one of your hired workers. So he got to his father, gave his speech, and in the version of the story that people were used to, the story they had all heard from their rabbis, the father looked behind himself, saw pig slop, picked it up, dumped it at the kid's feet, and said, "That's what you are to me." The narrative they had all heard was the narrative of the child who got exactly what he deserved. Jesus changed the story. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, changes our story. And he shocked everyone who was listening. When he was a long way off, I want you to picture it. It's a little speck. The father caught sight of him, ran to him, to you, embraced him, kissed him. The son started giving his speech. "Father, I've sinned against heaven. I've sinned against you." And the father cut him off. "Quick, bring the finest robe. Put it on him. Put a ring on his finger. Sandals on his feet. Take the fatted calf. Slaughter it. Let's celebrate with a feast. This son of mine was dead, and he's come to life again. He was lost, and he's been found." And then a celebration began. Guys, this is a beautiful saying that Jesus didn't just come to make bad people good. He came to make dead people alive. This is the reality we encounter at every Mass that we go to. This is the life we're brought into. But Jesus is saying, you know, stop making the narrative about some sin you committed. Stop making the story of your worth about what you accomplish. Stop thinking the story of your life is about a disease that inflicted your family or a divorce or some horrible dysfunctional relationship in your life, whatever it is. There's a bigger narrative that we're all part of. It's the love of Jesus Christ for us, and that's what teaches us who we are. When you come to Mass today, when you approach Jesus Christ in the Eucharist, and the priest or the Eucharistic minister holds up the Eucharist to you, not just to the whole world, but to you who feels like this doesn't apply to you, to each person here, and you hear body of Christ, when you say the word amen, I want you to say amen to the reality that this love is for you. Say amen. Choose to believe it, that this is the love story of your life. But this is what reminds you of who you are. Amen. Amen. Amen to the best news in history. And let's prepare our hearts to receive that great mystery and that great love with a song of praise before we begin our Mass.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. So you are, so you are, so you are.
Our God.
Let's just sing out.
Deliver me, oh God.
Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Sisters and brothers, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters,
that
I have greatly sinned.
In
my thoughts and my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault.
Therefore
I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels, saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. God of mercy and reconciliation, we offer your people who offer your people special days of salvation so that they may recognize you as Creator and Father of all. Mercifully come to our help, we pray, so that receiving gladly from you the message of peace, we may serve your will to restore all things in Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, whoever is in Christ is a new creation. The old things have passed away. Behold, new things have come. And all of this is from God, who has reconciled us to himself through Christ and given us the ministry of reconciliation. Namely, God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. So we are ambassadors for Christ, as if God were appealing through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who did not know sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to thy mercy, Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to listen to Jesus. But the Pharisees and scribes began to complain, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So to them, Jesus addressed this parable. A man had two sons, and the younger son said to his father, "Father, give me the share of your estate that should come to me." So the father divided the property between them. After a few days, the younger son collected all his belongings and set off to a distant country where he squandered his inheritance on a life of dissipation. When he had freely spent everything, a severe famine struck that country and he found himself in dire need. So he hired himself out to one of the local citizens, who sent him to his farm to tend the swine. And he longed to eat his fill of the pots on which the swine fed, but nobody gave him any. Coming to his senses, he thought, "How many of my father's hired workers have more than enough food to eat? But here am I, dying from hunger. I shall get up and go to my father, and I shall say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son. Treat me as you would treat one of your hired workers.'" So he got up and went back to his father. While he was still a long way off, his father caught sight of him and was filled with compassion. He ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. His son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son." But his father ordered his servants, "Quickly, bring the finest robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Take the fattened calf and slaughter it. Then let us celebrate with a feast, because this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found." Then the celebration began. Now, the older son had been out in the field, and on his way back, as he neared the house, he heard the sound of music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what this might mean. The servant said to him, "Your brother has returned, and your father has slaughtered the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." He became angry, and when he refused to enter the house, his father came out and pleaded with him. He said to his father in reply, "Look, all these years I served you, and not once did I disobey your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat to feast on with my friends. But when your son returns, who swallowed up your property with prostitutes, for him you slaughtered the fattened calf." He said to him, "My son, you are here with me always. Everything I have is yours. But now we must celebrate and rejoice, because your brother was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear brothers and sisters, it's me again. I'm sorry. And I think I have to apologize, for I did not see during my catechesis that there were people up there. So, I want to acknowledge you there. Yeah. They are the people in the peripheries there. Yeah. But you're very much part of the church. As we said during the catechesis, the theme of today's celebration, and of course the Eucharist, is opening ourselves to God's mercy, allowing ourselves to be touched by God's mercy. The gospel that we just heard proclaimed is the third parable of mercy in the 15th chapter of St. Luke. During the catechesis, we focused on the first two, the lost sheep, the lost coin, and we said, the Father looks for the lost sheep and the lost coin for no other reason than it is mine. But if the Father can say to a sheep, it is mine, if a woman can say to the lost coin, it is mine, which father cannot say to a son who has discovered my need for my Father? Why can he not say, you are mine? In the gospel, the father leaves the house twice. First, to welcome the prodigal son who squandered everything of his inheritance. The son who said, I am no longer fit to be called a son. He was willing to be treated like a hired servant. But the father, no. The father would not have it. The father restores to him his dignity as a son. You are mine. But then the father went out of the house again, a second time, to convince the elder son, supposedly the good son, to enter the house. Why? He refuses to be associated with the family. He told his father, I have labored for you. I have not given you any problem. Probably he was even an honor student. maybe even a scholar. I have not given you any problem. I've worked for you. You have not given me even a goat to celebrate with my feast, with my friends. And now that your son comes home, you welcome him. I have nothing to do with him. And I have nothing to do with you. He cannot accept a father who welcomes a sinner. But for all his goodness, this elder son did not feel like a son. He said, I labored for you. He considered himself a laborer, not a son. And when you labor, you expect your wages. He was expecting a goat, not sonship. And this is another way of losing the dignity of being son. The first is squandering God's gifts. The other is refusing to be a brother to sinners. The righteous, you live by yourselves. I have nothing to do with this family. And so the father leaves the house again and convinces him, your brother was lost and is found. Come home. You are both my sons. Come home. This is the father that we have. He goes out of his way to restore to us the dignity that we must possess as his children. Come home. Come home. Have no fear. You will find the Father. But be prepared. When you come home, you will find wounded, erring brothers and sisters. Don't say, I will look for another family. This is the home of the Father, with a love so great that even the wounded is restored to dignity. I visited a home for street girls. Girls who had grown up on the streets with all the violence, the abuse that the jungle of the streets of Manila could offer. So I was prepared to meet wounded, bitter, angry girls. Wow. They gave me the warmest welcome that I have ever received in my life. With exuberance, with genuine smiles, with songs, with dances. And they openly shared their horror stories. But with peace, without any rancor. This surprised me a lot. So I asked the two persons responsible for running the shelter, I asked them, wow, what is your secret? Why are these street girls not the angry, bitter girls that I was expecting them to be? And the group mother said, when they first entered this shelter, that's how they are. Then she told me the story of one girl who never smiled.
And the priest asked this girl, "What can we do and what will we do to make you smile?" And the girl said, "No one has taught me how to smile." So I asked them, "What did you do? Is there a seminar on smiling? I mean, is there a recipe? What do you do?" And they told me, "Just love them and make them feel loved. And slowly, the tears will turn to smiles. Welcome them with love, especially these girls who have not experienced love. And when they begin to appreciate what love is, then they stay. They don't go back to the streets. They stay. They have found a home, and they learn how to smile." Smile! Who can smile? Those who know they have been embraced by a father, even when they deserve to be pushed away. What they get is love. Then the heart learns how to smile again. Brothers and sisters, as we are gathered together under the divine mercy, let us pray in solidarity with all our brothers and sisters, bringing all our needs before our merciful Father.
We pray for our Holy Father, Pope Francis, Cardinal Jivish, Cardinal Tagle, and all bishops and priests, that the Lord would protect, strengthen, and guide them in their service to His church. We pray to the Lord. We pray for all world and civil leaders, that they be given the wisdom to find the paths to peace and the courage to work for the protection of the most vulnerable in society. We pray to the Lord.
Our prayer.
We pray for suffering Christians, that they may know the closeness of Jesus and the solidarity of all their brothers and sisters throughout the world. We pray to the Lord.
Our prayer.
We pray for all pilgrims here in Krakow for World Youth Day, that they may know the unfailing love of the Heavenly Father. We pray to the Lord.
O God, our refuge and our strength, hear the prayers of your church and grant us all that we need to be witnesses of your mercy for the whole world, through Christ our Lord. Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands.
Remember, Lord, that your Son, who is our peace and our reconciliation, has canceled the sin of the world with his blood. And as you look mercifully on your church's offerings, grant that we may extend to all the freedom of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just that we should give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you do not cease to spur us on to possess a more abundant life. And being rich in mercy, you constantly offer pardon and call on sinners to trust in your forgiveness alone. Never did you turn away from us. And though time and again we have broken your covenant, you have bound the human family to yourself through Jesus, your Son, our Redeemer, with a new bond of love so tight that it can never be undone. Even now, you set before your people a time of grace and reconciliation. And as they turn back to you in spirit, you grant them hope in Christ Jesus and a desire to be of service to all, while they entrust themselves more fully to the Holy Spirit. And so, filled with wonder, we extol the power of your love, and proclaiming our joy at the salvation that comes from you, we join in the heavenly hymn of countless hosts, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Stanislaw, our Bishop, and all the clergy.
Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to pray. Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Sign of peace. Thank you.
high on that.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh,
Let us pray. May the sacrament of your Son, which we have received, increase our strength, we pray, O Lord, that from this mystery of unity we may drink deeply of love's power and everywhere promote your peace. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a few announcements before you head off for the day. On page 22 in your little booklets is the afternoon schedule. Got a lot of great stuff planned for you here all day. You don't want to miss it. There's also one of our breakouts I want to point out to you on the patron saint of this day in the conference, Saint Brother Albert, who is a great artist. Any artists out there? Yeah. And he preserved culture and spread the kingdom through art and then gave his life to service of the poor. People who were not able to receive communion, we got you covered, okay? There was a couple people on the tops that didn't get communion. Go to the small arena where the chapel is. We'll have communion for you there. And if people can make sure, because it got crowded there yesterday, that those folks get through your crowd to Holy Communion. A couple other things. I want to give you free stuff. I want to give you a talk that I've given, our videos, and a chance to win a trip with me to the Holy Land. After Mass, not during, open up your smartphones, go to reallifecatholic.com, sign up for the newsletter. That's how you get all that, reallifecatholic.com. I want to thank Cardinal Tagle and all of our cardinals and priests and bishops. Thank you. Yes. I want to thank the Dominican Liturgical Institute for their music. Beautiful. And the store on level A. They'll have a store for you on level A as well. I want to thank the Sisters of Life and all the religious and everybody went into planning this. And most especially, I want to thank the Knights of Columbus, without whom this event absolutely would not have happened. They funded this whole thing. I'm proud to be a Knight of Columbus. I want to thank them for this. Thank you.
Thanks to everyone. And may I add one more announcement? 2 days ago, the sequel to the UCAT was launched. It is called DoCAT, What the Young People Should Do. It is a catechesis on the social teachings of the church. I think Pope Francis will give that as a gift to all the youth delegates. You will have a copy of the DoCAT. But we want to give the Pope and the church 1 million young people who would do something for society inspired by the social teachings of the church. I don't know where the flyers, the brochures will be distributed, but please, 1 million for the church and for the Holy Father. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Now and forever.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Sorry, folks. One final announcement. Because of the rain, the things that were planned for the outdoor stage will be right here. We have Scott and Annie Powell and Jason Everett on your schedule. 12:45 will be here, not at the outdoor stage. Thank you.